From the beginning of the year 2021 till date, the Nigerian economy remained an issue of concern as it kept throwing up one matter or the other. Among the so many things that came to the fore on the economic scene in 2021 is the planned total removal of the fuel subsidy by 2022. The government said it will replace it with a 5,000 monthly stipend for poorest of the poor. Another was the announcement of the National Development Plan 2021 to 2025. It is to replace the Economic Recovery and Growth Plan, which expired in December 2020. The e-Naira was introduced in 2021. What about the drop in inflation and the trouble with the exchange rates? The year also witnessed discussions about the amendment of the Finance Act 2020, which provides for the establishment of the fund from the Consolidated Revenue Fund and special accounts in sum of 500 billion naira, or any other sum as may be approved by the National Assembly. So many issues showed up in the year on the Nigerian economic scene. And here this morning, we have Professor Segun Ajibola, a banker, lawyer, a professor of economics in Babcock University, Ogun State, who is also a former president of the Chartered Institute of Bankers of Nigeria. He will be helping us review the economy in 2021. Good morning, Prof.
Good morning, Prof.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good to have you, Prof, and Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Thank you very much, and same to you.
Thank you very much. Talk to us, Prof. You know what has happened throughout the year. It's been a helluva of a year. The biggest economy in Africa, sadly, is now the biggest, the capital, the poverty capital of the world. Is that what you think that we will remember Nigeria by for the year that is about to end, 2021?
Definitely not.
Okay.
Year 2021 raised a lot of hope for the Nigerian economy. Okay. Let's not forget where we are coming from. Mm. It's been a very challenging moment, especially since 2016, when we first entered into recession.
Yeah.
We struggled to get out of the recession, and indeed we got out. Then the pandemic came and another recession. But if we look at the trajectory from 2016 up until this 2021, we've seen a mix of circumstances, situations confronting us as a country, as an economy, in these last 5 years. But year 2021 in particular, we can say that it's a year that we recorded some modest improvement in the economy. We shouldn't forget that the pandemic,
yes,
has been out. We should also remember that the global economy itself was so badly battered, especially in 2020. So when we combine all this, we could see clearly the impact on the economy. But the good news has been that year 2021 announced us out of recession that has been with us for quite some time. Year 2021 showed some improvement in certain segments of our national economy that have been challenged over the years. So we could see improvement in the rate of growth of the risk sector of the economy that has been torturing for quite some time.
All right, thank you, Prof. Ajibola.
Okay, for quite a long time, we could see a growth that was not oil and gas induced. Okay. Growth that touched the risk sector of the national economy. So if we put all this together, we could say emphatically that year 2021 There are lots of things to rejoice about. There are a lot of things to celebrate as an economy, although we can say that it is still not yet Uhuru for us.
Right, Prophet Jibola, thank you for that. Thanks for it. Sounds like a very positive outlook, from your end there. Could we possibly say, now talking about what to expect in the upcoming year, could we possibly say that 2021 will be some sort of bellwether of good tidings, so to say? Or is there anything ominous that could possibly, that we should be considered, that we should consider ahead of 2022 economically?
Okay, let's look at it this way. I want us to also appreciate the fact that growth itself is not sufficient condition for development. As a developing nation, we always run into this logjam where we have growth, but the lacuna is growth without development. Because for you to develop, you must be able to put quality food on the table of your citizenry. All the indicators that measure quality of life must move up. That's development. So we are still struggling as an economy with this issue. But let's take it from where the question came. What do we expect to translate 2021 to 2022, how do we translate the positive signs that we have seen in 2021? And we also have the negative signs. How do we translate that to 2022? I will say, first of all, in 2022, we need to up the ante. There are lots of incentives that have been introduced in the last couple of years to encourage small to medium enterprises, tax incentives, if a tax holiday in some cases, the question of infrastructure, we still have challenge of insecurity, and so on. Generally, when we talk about the ease of doing business, we've seen some improvements, but we need to do more as we move to year 2022. Also, we've talked about it all over and over. What do we do about sustaining some of the good tidings that we have seen from some years up to this moment? We need, as an economy, to be sure that we implement some of the incentives that we have introduced as an economy, and that we are able to translate some of those policies that we have seen that could contribute positively to our economy. We need to translate into implementable trajectory. So we still have the challenge of this. Then we have also seen an economy that is no longer totally relying on the oil and gas sector. We are seeing some element of diversification. We are seeing improvement in agri. We are seeing improvement in small to medium enterprises. We are seeing improvement in the manufacturing segment. If we can translate all this into 2022 templates, then we'll be able to say that we are now seeing an economy that is coming on stronger than what we used to have.
All right, Prof. I mean, I like your optimism, and the kind words that you have used, in assessing the impact of the economy in 2021 and how it should proceed into the new year. But I'm not so sure if a lot of Nigerians will share this optimism. 2021 has been a year in which many people struggled with disposable income. If you look at the price of gas, for example, that's been a recurrent issue for a long time. So people will wonder, when you say all these things,
We are coming to that, Mr. Moderator.
Oh, okay. So
maybe we should take that aspect off.
I can allow you, but I'm just trying to ask in specific terms that this beautiful outlook that you have painted, how much of it are Nigerians feeling that? If you add the issue of foreign exchange to it. Nothing has changed since the intervention of the central bank, which accused Aboki FX of the one, you know, causing all the havoc. Aboki FX has been taken out of the equation now, but nothing significant has been recorded as far as foreign exchange is concerned. There is also the question of who really is running the economy. Is it the CBN governor? Is it the Minister of Finance? Who's in charge, you know, of the economy? Those are the things that Nigerians, I'm sure, will be interested in knowing. And not just, maybe, you know, for want of a better word, you know, textbook achievements that you have painted beautifully, even though I concede that, yes, it's not all gloom, but then are we feeling it as a people? Are Nigerians happier, financially speaking, than they were in 2016 that you referred to when we came out of recession?
Yes, Mr. Moderator, do not forget that the sum of my initial analysis,
yes, sir,
is that we are still struggling,
okay,
as a people with the problem of growth without development. Most of the issues that you have raised border on the quantum of development. But unfortunately, most times, analysts, even if you go through the World Bank report, if you go through most of the international rating agencies, we over-concentrate on the issue of growth. But growth is not sufficient condition for development. So we still have problem with the issue of development. And it is the development index that will resolve most of the issues that you've talked about. We have challenge here. There's no point. The issue of inflation, which has eroded the purchasing power of the people. The issue of foreign exchange rate, which has created cost push inflation again and has affected the cost of living of an average Nigerian. I mentioned the issue of security that has affected even product, even farmers, even cost of food, even quality of food. The issue of security has made problem of kidnapping, problem of robbery, and so on and so forth. They are all affected. There's no doubt about this. And we've also talked about what can we do to even encourage production? What can we do to sustain manufacturing? These are issues in our economy. So the question now is, what do we do to address these issues? And I talk about, if we have incentives and we cannot implement incentives, it's like a paper tiger. We just end up with very beautiful ideas, beautifully couched policies that we are unable to implement. But I will not go into maybe some of the questions that I am not in a position to answer, who runs the economy and so on and so forth. But from the point of view of an analyst that sees what is on ground, we can also say that we still have element of disconnect between the monetary side. So when you talk about the central bank and other regulatory institutions, the disconnect between the monetary aspect and the fiscal aspect, which is what you are trying to raise by asking the question, where lies the responsibility of a central bank, for example, and where lies the responsibility of a minister of finance? We do know that for any economy to be on ground, fully on ground, and to be able to move forward, there must be a very warm handshake between the monetary side and the fiscal side. Without that handshake, there will be disconnect. And if that nexus is not there, we will not be able to run a cohesive economy that will be able to move forward in a unified form. All these issues are there. But what we are saying is, when we identify what can give us some strength as an economy, how do we build on that so that in building on our strengths, we'll be able to overcome our weaknesses. If we continue to emphasize our weaknesses, we'll be cloud the areas where we can improve and where we can translate that improvement to better living conditions for average Nigerians. I think this is where we are not moving together, Mr. Moderator. But the summary of what I am saying is this. Let's identify those things that have given us some improvement. All through this, the three quarters of this year, we have recorded positive growth. The question then is, how do we translate the three quarters of positive growth into subsequent quarters of development? We still have a challenge there.
All right, Professor Ajibola, we are right there with you. We need to take a very quick break. When we return, we're going to keep unpacking this. Stay with us. All right, welcome back to The Morning Show. We've been talking to Professor Segun Ajibola. Prof, thank you for staying with us. You've been talking a lot about drawing parallels between growth and development. Let's talk about what the term development means to the man on the street. Let's go all the way back to the grassroots. As Steve was asking before, we want to talk about what do these actual terms mean to a guy who just wants to, you know, have three square meals and have a roof over his head. What is that outlook for him in 2022?
Yes, thank you. That's the most important question to me as an individual. How is the man on the street feeling the impact of the economy? The man on the street is concerned about having his 3 square meals a day, food, 3 basic necessities of life will determine the quality of development. Good clothing and shelter. But if you look at the various indices across
Okay, it seems like we have a bit of a technical difficulty there. We will continue to have this discussion in studio and, of course, wait to reconnect and carry on with Professor Segun Ajibola there. So, Steve, of course, Prof is talking about you know, the need, which is what I'm asking. What about the man on the street? You know, we could have, we understand that we have Prof now, and of course, we'll continue to carry on with that conversation. Prof, can you hear us? Prof Ajibola, are you with us?
I'm telling you.
All right, Prof, let's carry on, please.
Hello, Prof. Can you hear us, Prof? We lost you a bit there earlier. If you can.
Are you not hearing?
Okay, Prof, let's
We can hear you, Prof.
If you could just try to take a sentence, let's see how well we can get that from you. If we can't, we're going to have to progress with this conversation. But let's try again, Prof. Could you please say something to us?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we're with you. All right, Prof.
Okay. I was just trying to explain that the man on the street is concerned about the quality of his life in terms of his accessibility to food, basic necessities of life, food, clothing, and shelter. So we need to ask ourselves, what is the quality of life that the man on the street can boast of as of today? Mm. Then when we even go a step further, and we expand that definition of development. I was just trying to borrow from what is normally the standard of measurement by international institutions and agencies, like the World Bank. World Bank talks about Human Development Index, which is a composite index. Looks at the quality of food, the quality of healthcare, of infrastructure like energy, like security, like inflation, like unemployment, and so on and so forth. When we put all these things together, as of today, we are still very, very low on the ladder as a country, as Nigeria. So which means, in summary, the man, the average man in Nigeria is still struggling with the issue of development. And that is why the statistics are there that about 60% of our population as Nigerians still struggle to live below the poverty line. In other words, that percentage, they've not been able to provide for their basic necessities of life. And that is the measure of poverty. And that is the challenge that we do have And when we now look at what is happening in and around, like some of the issues we mentioned before, the cost of living is still very high. It worsens off when inflationary pressure is getting worse. That has been fueled by the depreciation in the value of our currency, which has pushed up cost of production, passed on to end users. That's a problem. We have a problem of energy, that we are unable to access quality energy. Even the man on the street, be a welder, be an hairdresser, is unable to practice his trade because of the challenge he has with basic infrastructure that is there. We have a problem of security. Farmers have been chased out of their farms, and so on and so forth. So when we put all these things together, it is clear that majority of Nigerians, the man on the street, is still struggling to cater for himself, and that is measure of poverty. Secondly, we also see a situation where as Nigerians, we have problem of what we call distributive injustice. Distributive injustice means when you have a sizable portion of your resources in the hands of a very negligible percentage of the population. The statistics available to us today show that about 80-90% of the Nigerians' economic resources are in the hands of less than 10% of the population. That's what economists call distributive injustice. In other words, even the resources that we have are not going around. Very negligible percentage hold on to that resources. So it's not going around. The average man is not getting his fair share. He's not getting the food on his table. And that has been our problem from independence to date. We are still struggling to address that. The question then arises, how do we move out of this quagmire? Some steps have been taken. For example, we need to address the problem of income distribution and income redistribution. If you see some of the provisions of Finance Bill 2020-2021 going to 2022, tries to introduce certain policies to redistribute income, but not sufficiently robust to address this fundamental problem. We've also seen some incentives being introduced for small scalers to encourage that segment of our national economy. We need more. Then we need faithful implementation of most of these policies that we are talking about. Now we are going back to the issue of national development plan. We saw what national development plans did in the life of Nigeria from 1962 to 68, first national development plan, 70 to 74, 75 to 80, 81 to 85. Four national development plan before social adjustment came and we started toying with semantics and so on and so forth. We are now back to national development plan 2021 to 2025. The question is, with the beautiful provisions that there are, we going to have the will, have the commitment to implement those things provided for in the national development plan so that the man on the street at the end of the day will be able to say yes, I have better quality food on my table now. I can boast of better shelter. I can boast of other things that measure quality of life, access to energy, electricity, and so on, security of lives and property, healthcare, educational facilities, road, and so on and so forth. All these facilities that determine quality of life, and we see it in developed economies. How will Nigerians at the end, for example, of this development plan 2021 to 2025, how will Nigeria be able to measure the performance of that development plan in terms of all the accessibility to all these facilities that we talk about? That is the time we'll be able to talk about growth and development. Otherwise, we are still struggling with this, like almost all African nations, this problem of growth without development. So these are areas, these are issues, these are policies, these are implementation challenges that we must address, Mr. Moderator, if our story is going to change in year 2022 and moving forward.
Yeah, but Prof, we want to know, how do we address it? So we understand the realities of what's on ground. What is the best way to address it aggressively? Otherwise, this becomes a conversation that is just recurring over and over again. So what would you say the key measures are, the key prerequisites for addressing developmental issues in Nigeria? And we have to take this quite briefly, please, Prof, as we are approaching the end of the segment, please, Prof.
Okay, yes, I'm very brief. You know, our problem as a people and as a country is we talk too much. And that is why most times we run into a problem of motion without development. We have never run out of ideas about what to do. It's the doing that is the problem. Talk is cheap. Walking the talk is expensive. So all that we have seen, number one, there must be faithful implementation of policies. Responsible institutions and agencies must be prepared to implement, and there must be element of accountability. If we have 2021-2025 National Development Plan, the provisions of those plans must be assigned to those who are responsible for implementation, and we must have accountability template. Otherwise, we keep talking without anybody doing anything. Number two, other incentives that we have introduced, how do we implement them? We talk about tax incentives. People are still complaining about multiple taxes. How do we stop this? There must be definite actions from institutions and agencies that are responsible to ensure that those incentives are implemented. And we have a template that measures the rate of success. Then we must also shift our orientation from being an import dependent in almost everything, including food, to that slogan of using what we can produce and producing what we can use. As of today, we are still overexposed to the external economy. And that is why whenever anything happens to our exchange rate, it affects the man on the street. So how do we come back home and rely more? India did it, and India economy is better for it today. In China, Chinese can produce anything, they consume. Chinese economy is enjoying that today. Nigeria, after 60 years, how do we domesticate our basic needs? So the plans, the programs that we talk about in agriculture, it's not enough to give farmers money. How do we encourage that the money even gets to those who are in the farm, those who are on this particular job? How do we ensure? So that it's not a question of resource distribution problem again. So each segment of our national economy, we must have the ministries, agencies responsible to give accountability template. Where were we December 2020, December 2021? Where exactly are we beyond rhetoric? Otherwise, like you say, Mr. Moderator, we keep talking without doing anything. And talk is cheap. Implementation, faithful implementation, the way to do the right thing. If we can develop all this, I tell you, we don't need fresh ideas. Ideas have been harvested for years in this country. Imagine what the Minister of Finance said the other time. Nigeria Economic Summit Group have been meeting for 25 years. And she said, if Nigeria had implemented just 25% of all the recommendations from NESG, Nigeria would have been a different country. Why did we fail in the implementation process? Because we gather together year in, year out, speaking about the same problems, and we leave this year, we come back next year to start from level zero, as if we've never seen ourselves before. As if all the issues we are discussing, nobody in this country has identified all those issues before. And that is why I talk about most times we run into the problem of motion without movement. These are the areas we need to improve, Mr. Moderator. If we are able to faithfully implement, faithfully hold people accountable, that's problem of accountability. Make sure that the resources we have, they are applied to develop our own environment. Make sure that we look inwards in solving our economic needs, and we are not overexposed to the rest of the world in providing for our basic needs, including food. We will have moved several steps forward.
All right, Prof.
We have a new song to sing.
All right, Prof, thank you so much. I mean, you've been very clear and detailed. about all the issues, faithful implementation of the policies, and we are not short on ideas, as you said. You know, brilliant submission. We must thank you for this engagement with us today, and we do wish you a happy Christmas. Thank you so much, Prof.